If you're still getting food, please continue. And if you're wandering the tables, that's fine as well. I have some announcements to go over. I also was just going to tell you we had a little bit of change in what may be in the bulletin as far as some of the order and who's doing what. I'm just going to run through and be doing almost everything until the end, I think, until Lisa comes up to talk. Well, other than maybe doing the music, that's going to be Mark. So we switched some of it up. Also, we moved the opening song to after my message because I figured, you know, everyone here is so committed to singing, we might have pancake particles flying on people. So we thought we'd give you a little more time to eat and enjoy the pancakes that have been prepared for us. And let's just first, I think if we can just maybe give a little applause for the hands that made our breakfast, how delicious it was, and thank you very much. And one more for the people who have worked really hard to set up this event. Thank you so much. All right, please enjoy your food and I'll begin to go over our announcements. One of the first ones we have is a book of members for the new pastor. And we have some papers up there for a template. I believe there's a spot to put a picture and put some other information. So please get yours so that we can give that to the pastor. And if at the end of this service you're like, I don't know where to go, let someone know and we'd be more than happy to get that form or make it available for you. So please let us know so we can help with that because we have our directory, but it's been a few years since we've done that. And we just want to have something new for people to be able to see or for our new pastor to see. Also, we have a big gift basket for new pastor and family that also has some information at the back of the sanctuary. So again, they need all the items by November 12th. So if you can bring those, and again, if you need help finding where that's at, let somebody know and we can be more than happy to help guide you or do whatever we need to help with that. Also, our Christmas food boxes. Bring items each week. Items for today are 12 to 18 ounce box cereal and 16 to 32 ounce bags of rice. So that's what we're working for today. What is today? Today's the 27th. The 27th, sorry, I was looking at the wrong line here. Is spaghetti sauce and spaghetti noodles. And do we have something for the next week that we need to?
Yeah, it's on the yellow sheet.
The yellow sheet.
Do you have one?
So, yellow sheet in your bulletin. So it's the spaghetti. And then next week is a plastic jar of peanut butter, plastic containers of jelly, grape or strawberry, and cans of corn. So if you can bring those items next week, that would be great so that we can fill up those boxes. All right, move my papers around. Next we have Operation Christmas Child Food Boxes. Are those food? No. There's not food, just child boxes. Gift boxes, sorry. And too many boxes up here. So the child boxes and right over here. So I think you can grab a box if you need to fill it. And is there something in there for?
The deadlines are on one side of the green sheet.
So in the insert here, the green one, please look at that one. And it has your information that you, what you can bring and what is needed and the information. So look at that one. Okay, let's see here. Fill the soup bowl. During the month of October, local churches were asked to make donations to fill the soup bowl and thus help emergency aid with funds to help people in the community of need. Donation box is back of the sanctuary. And so we have it down here. Great. So look over there and if we can make a donation to help meet that need, that would be great. Thank you. And then we have Thanksgiving dinner. Our Thanksgiving dinner will be November 17th, a 10 a.m. service time and at 11 a.m. Dinner. Sign-up sheets for food and attendance will be at the back of the sanctuary starting Tuesday, October 29th. We only really have two Sundays to get people signed up for things, so please make sure you're looking at that and help with that with what you can. All right. And last, we get a sip of water.
I don't see that in the script at all.
Last, we also have Charge Conference coming up, and we will be meeting here at the church on November 3rd at 3 p.m. So if you want to come and be a part of that, it'd be great. We are needing any type of sweetbreads or cookies because we'll have various other churches here as we go through the conference. And they approve basically who's on their committees, their budgets, and they go through that information. But they don't go through like order, but they just talk about it and they do various votes. So please feel welcome to come. And if you would like to provide cookies or sweetbreads, even if you don't come, that would be great. Thank you.
Sign up sheet for the cookies is over here.
Oh, sign up sheet for cookies is back there. Is there any other announcements that we have? Okay, if that is it, let's see what we got next here. Friday dinner prayer. Okay, so if you all, I said we moved the singing, but now we're going to do a call of worship. So maybe take a drink of water or something to cleanse the palate or and get ready, and we'll do call of worship.
I'm going to do a coffee break.
And you should find the words in your bulletin. What is the greatest commandment?
To love God with all our hearts, minds, and souls.
And the second?
To love your neighbor as yourself.
And why are these two so important?
All the law and the prophets hang on these two commandments.
All right. I will begin with our scripture. I do have to make a correction. In sending the scripture over, I put the correct for Matthew chapter 22, verses 36 through 40, but I put the incorrect words that went with that. So I will correct it. But as far as getting a mistake, having one talking about Jesus bringing on the children and being with them and kind of rebuking them for rejecting the children for what we're doing today seems like a good mistake. So maybe God was trying to speak to me through in that. But we will go through actually the three scriptures. So the first one is Matthew chapter 12, verse 1 through 14. At that time, Jesus went through the grain fields on the Sabbath. His disciples were hungry and began to pick some heads of grain and eat them. When the Pharisees saw this, they said to him, "Look, your disciples are doing what is unlawful on the Sabbath." He answered, "Haven't you read what David did when he and his companions were hungry? He entered the house of God, and he and his companions ate the consecrated bread, which was not lawful for them to do, but only for the priests. Or haven't you read in the law that the priests on the Sabbath in the temple desecrate the Sabbath? And yet are innocent. I tell you that something greater than the temple is here. If you had known what these words mean, 'I desire mercy, not sacrifice,' you would not have condemned the innocent. For the Son of Man is Lord of the Sabbath." Going on from that place, he went into their synagogue, and a man with a shriveled hand was there, looking for a reason to bring charges against Jesus. They asked him, "Is it lawful to heal on the Sabbath?" He said to them, "If any of you has a sheep and it falls into a pit on the Sabbath, would you not take hold of it and lift it out? How much more valuable is a person than a sheep? Therefore it is lawful to do good on the Sabbath." Then he said to the man, "Stretch out your hand." So he stretched it out, and it was completely restored, just as sound as the other. But the Pharisees went out and plotted how they might kill Jesus. All right, our next one. This one is Matthew chapter 19, verse 13 through 15, and this is the one about the little children. Then little children were brought to Jesus for him to place his hands on them and pray for them. But the disciples rebuked those who brought them. Jesus said, "Let the little children come to me, and do not hinder them, for the kingdom of heaven belongs to such as these." And when he had placed his hand on them, he went on from there. And then our next one, Matthew chapter 22, verse 34 through 40. Hearing that Jesus had silenced the Sadducees and the Pharisees got together, one of them, an expert in the law, tested him with the question, "Teacher, which is the greatest commandment in the law?" Jesus replied, "Love your Lord, your God, with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment, and the second is like it. Love your neighbor as yourself. All of the laws and the prophets hang on these two commandments." All right. So, I'm going to tell you, I started trying to think of the message to give today, and I was kind of coming up short as far as what to really say when there are so much other things going on. But so I decided to keep it a little short because I feel like there's other things that we can be doing here today of being around each other, having some fun over here, but also doing a good cause and not taking away from that. But I also did a few looking around, and in the passages I picked about commandments, I thought it'd be interesting to do a little bit of trivia about some commandments. And then I happened to leave my notes at home that had some of the answers, but I do remember a few of them, or close to it. So what is the number of commandments that we find in the Old Testament? More?
Isn't it like in the
600s? It is in the 600s. I think it's 631 commandments. Does anyone know what the first commandment was?
Try to remember that last.
Don't eat apples.
Well, it is in Genesis, and it's to be fruitful and multiply. And does anyone know when people, according to the Bible, were given permission to actually eat meat? After the flood. If you read, there is actually a statement that we are now allowed to eat meat. So, however you want to take that, Adam and Eve were vegetarians, and everyone up to that point may have been vegetarians, I don't know. But that was when the first commandment comes to say, you're allowed to eat meat. Now, of the 631 commandments, most of them have been kind of not in practice because a lot of them refer to the temple. And so since we're not actively at the temple or with that, those commandments don't really apply. And what we see that I find interesting as we get to this story about Jesus is they have all these rules about what you can or cannot do on the Sabbath. That somehow walking through a field and picking up grain to feed someone who's hungry is a violation of the Sabbath. And so Jesus brings up this point. I don't know if you're as familiar with this about David going to the temple. David is on the run from Saul. Saul wants to kill him. So he gets his men together and he heads to the temple. Now, he actually walks into the temple, up to the high priest, and he says, "I'm on an errand for Saul. I need some food. And if you have any weapons, that would be great." He's lying to the high priest. Now, mind you, the high priest in the temple, this is David lying. And the high priest is like, well, we can give you this bread. And the bread is consecrated, supposed to be for the priest. But the high priest gives him the bread and gives him some weapons. And they leave. Now, what Jesus is bringing to point here is that almost all of them celebrate David as a revered figure. And nowhere does it indicate that David was found guilty of violating the law. And I know we can say, well, you know, a sin's a sin, but it feels like there might be a little bit bigger deal of going to the actual high priest in the temple and lying to try to get something you need. And yet there was nothing in there that said David was wrong, he had to seek forgiveness, and he's even celebrated for the actions that he did. And Jesus brings us up that here you celebrate this person as a great figure, and he violated the law. And what Jesus reminds us is that it is mercy, and that sometimes it's not just the temple that's important. There are things that are more important than the temple. And in going through this, I think it's so important that we look at this, because it reminds us that even what we're doing today, we're coming together to raise money to help a ministry for people that most of us will probably never meet. And for the most part, we will not know the extent it had an impact on their life. We will send this off. We might hear stories, but for each individual person, what it meant to them or what it may have done for them, we probably will never know. And how wonderful it is that we are able to help the people of Honduras in the work that we do and in what we are trying to do. And so, you know, I think about this passage of even that ended up here in Mistake, of not rebuking the children and remembering the people that we're trying to help, and to open our hearts to that, to open our hearts to, you know, being more than just caught up sometimes, because it's easy to get caught up in all the things going on in our own life. I think about it even as a parent, how easy it is to be doing one thing and the next thing and the next thing, and then it's like, oh my gosh, I have kids I should spend time with. I was talking with someone about being a parent, and I was like, you know, my wife and I are very fortunate because we have jobs that allows us to spend a lot of time with our kids. We have a lot because I get to work from home, and so it just really opens a lot of time that we can be there for our kids. But I know a lot of parents who, they go to work early in the morning, they work late, and then when they get home, they have to get things ready for the next day. They're making dinner or they're helping their kids do their work. And if they get their kids to bed at a certain time, they maybe get 1 to 2 hours of quality time with their kids. And that can be a struggle. It can be hard because sometimes we get so caught up in everything that needs to get done, we forget about those other things we should be doing that are just as important or even more important. So as we're going through today, I hope that we will be reminded of that mercy is, and let me make sure I get this, I desire mercy, not sacrifice. And that we recognize that when Jesus says, I tell you that something greater than the temple is here. There is something greater here because it's the work that we do and how we connect and reach people. And this is an amazing opportunity for us. So I encourage you all, have a little fun and know that the fun you're doing is helping others. And enjoy each other as a time of fellowship and taking time to maybe let some of those things going on around you just be in the side and focus on the person in front of you. Have a great rest of your time, and I'm going to do a prayer, and then I think we're going to do a song.
We got Lisa, I don't know how.
We're going to do a song and then go to Lisa.
Okay.
Yeah. So, thank you, Lord, for bringing us here today, and just giving us an opportunity to do your work and to have fellowship and to think about what it is that we do for others and that you have given us that ability to do that. We ask that you continue to be with us and help us remember that we are your servants and that we are serving your will. We thank you for this opportunity. We thank you for the many blessings we have. And we are so grateful for how many people have come together to make this happen. And we are grateful for all the people that come together to make so many of the other events that happen in this church work. Please continue to be with us. Please be with the people of Honduras and to the many people who are helping them, whether indirectly or directly, and helping this ministry continue to create pathways for people to come and not just know you, but to have a life that they can thrive and have more opportunities to just have an experience that reflects the beauty of the world that you've created. In your name, amen.
Amen.
You want this one? Okay. So we're going to sing Wonderful Words of Life.
Riding along, looking at the sun come up. Thank you so much for having us and for once again hosting this amazing event. I'm going to get my phone and my camera, and we're going to take some pictures so that the people in Honduras know that you are supporting them, because it's not just about the money or the projects. It's truly about being one in the family of Christ and for them to feel that love, especially in these incredibly difficult times. I don't think they're necessarily any easier here at home. But I have so much to tell you about with regard to amazing improvements that have happened this year. I'm super excited for you to get the newsletter that will be coming out here in November that will sort of give more detail. But let me just kind of run over a few things for you so you can kind of know where we're at. I finally feel like I get to stand in front of you and say we're getting closer to self-sufficiency, which is amazing given the fact that the economy is probably worse than it's ever been. But so we have been investing in education for a long time. We put a physician through school, we put a dentist through school, and we've now put a clinical psychologist through school. And I'm really pleased to tell you that our clinical psychology program is up and running. And that entails clinical services in addition to all of the mental health work that we are doing in the outlying villages and the group kind of therapies that we are providing for things like alcoholism, substance abuse, domestic violence, those kinds of issues where we have more than one person coming in at a time. Our little clinical psychologist is traveling once a week to San Pedro Sula. She is shadowing and learning more about children's therapy services as well. So we are now offering adult services and to some degree children's services. And it is our hope that we will also be the only center of its kind to be able to offer pediatric evaluations for things like autism spectrum disorders and other developmental disorders so that we can properly prepare a referral and get kids that need help into the right services in the city. She's so busy that she is frequently full every single day. And then she also goes out into the outlying areas and gives chats, often to groups of mothers, or sometimes to the adolescents who haven't yet found a place. And so she is really busy. And we put her fee at the same price that we put our medical exam fees, and people are extremely happy to pay that symbolic fee and so grateful for the services. We have already referred some super interesting cases, one of which was a case of undiagnosed schizophrenia. And we have a cooperating psychiatrist and a neurologist in San Pedro Sula who are willing to see our patients free of charge or for symbolic costs. And we've now got those patients on the proper medications, and then our physicians there in the clinic are able to do the follow-up with that. We lost our dentist, Dr. Pena, earlier this year. He explained that he wanted to learn English and perhaps specialize. So he's here in the United States right now doing intensive English, preparing to apply for some specialty programs. And he's very excited, and we are very sad that we lost him. But we have a dandy new dentist, a really nice lady who has come to us full-time with a commitment to stay permanently because she's from the area and she's raising children. She's a single mom, and I'm standing here and I cannot believe I cannot come up with her last name. You'll have to forgive me, but you'll read all about it in the newsletter. But the great thing about her is that she was in private dentistry for quite some time. I'm embarrassed. I'm completely drawing up like, well, I haven't had coffee yet this morning. That's a bad thing. My cognitive function is on the lower end today. So anyway, she had more experience than any of the dentists that we've ever been able to employ. And so she's doing endodontic procedures. She's doing some periodontal procedures. And we are really proud to be able to balance our patients who are unable to pay anything, those who are able to pay symbolic fees, and now we are drawing paying patients who are coming all the way up to the mountain to have her dental services. And people have expressed a lot of delight, and I am thrilled that we have additional funds coming in. Not only are we now covering the entire cost of the, oh, bless you. Oh, thank you. See, I always feel loved when I come here. This is great. So not only are we able in the dental realm to cover the cost of the replacements for the material and provide high quality materials like real resin, not silver amalgam fillings anymore, but we have natural tooth colored fillings. We're able to do all of that. We're able to pay for those, and we're getting very close to being able to at least pay half of her salary, if not more. The government just raised the minimum wage for dentists, so it's going to be a little bit longer, but I'm pleased. We have more income coming in through those two venues. Then the nurses got together. They decided that we needed to offer for sale medications that we generally don't use, perhaps because they're over the counter in the clinical part when we're prescribing treatments for patients. So they created a whole section of the clinic to be able to offer. Is my son okay back there? Is he sitting still? Okay. Got to check on little buddy too. They created a whole section in the pharmacy for over-the-counter medications and are selling some of those type of items in order to be able to bring in extra income. And that has helped to supplement the income that is coming into the pharmacy. And so now we are beginning to broaden our pharmaceuticals to some of the higher priced medications that we need for special cases that we simply couldn't afford to offer before. So extremely excited about all of those things. Then with regard to our agriculture program, we continue to raise pork and chicken and lots of vegetables and some fruit. We have some fruit trees now on the property that are starting to produce. But the really great thing is we have almost 200 laying hens now. And so our egg production has skyrocketed. And that's why you're starting to see these pictures of the school lunches with egg soup, which is really like hard-boiled eggs with beans and vegetables and all these things mixed in. The kids absolutely love it. We have been able to provide more villages with more school lunches because we have more than doubled our egg production. And recently, within the last 3 months, we received a gift of monies from First Methodist in Chanute, and we decided to double our meat production for chickens. And so now what our agronomist is doing is he has a regular route that he makes when we go out into the villages, and he goes around to the other surrounding villages and he sells our products wholesale to the other little stores and things to make meat more affordable for those who can't travel to our trade store. And our chicken meat is sold out. We're butchering somewhere around 150 to 170 birds every 3 weeks. And our meat is still selling out within the week. Wow. And so I think, you know, in the plans are perhaps to look for some more property at some point and even expand further. But I am delighted with the income that has generated for the agriculture program. And for the first time in the history of the mission, we are able to be much more generous with many more villages to ensure that the kids are getting school lunches. And we're keeping very close track of who's malnourished and who isn't. And we're going to be able to, I hope, be able to show you some empirical proof of the impact that those school lunch programs are having. So we're thrilled with that. And then, of course, you have seen, I think, Jan, correct me if I'm wrong, we definitely sent quite a few pictures of all of the school supplies. Or do you have them? You guys did the most amazing job with the school supplies this year. I did not know how in the world we were ever going to cover the amount of need that was presented to us. And of course, word travels. And so every little school in every little corner of our service area and some outside of our service area were begging for school supplies. And I'm just so thrilled to tell you that we were able to provide for every single school and every single student that asked for help. And that was just shy of 2,000 students. And that's from you guys. You did that. And so with this ever-changing world and with technology running, you know, at lightning speed, it's really critical that these kids get basic education. That's what's up right now. Yeah, we had amazing loads of school supplies to haul all the way up the mountain. And I kept getting these. I think the staff thought that they were doing a great favor by showing me all of the school supplies spread out all over the floor. But there was just a hint of desperation in their eyes as they were assembling this tremendous amount of school supply bags. And the teachers were really great with us this year. They gave us the absolute bare minimum of what they absolutely needed for the kids to start the school year. And then we had a small list of resupplies that we supplied each school so that if the kids ran out of school supplies, the teachers had a way to replenish those supplies. And I'm very thrilled about that because when COVID hit, the teachers who did not live in those villages stopped coming and the kids stopped getting education. And so I feel that one of the reasons the teachers return to these rural areas, even though the government has defaulted on their monthly salaries multiple times in the past several years, the reason they came back is because they knew at the very least they could count on the kids being there and they would have the supplies that they need. And so, you know, I just applaud you for what you have done. How do you share the love of Christ and really mean it? You know, more than the, I know we've all seen the memes and heard about the thoughts and prayers, but if this doesn't say thoughts and prayers and that Jesus has not forgotten about you and that you are truly loved, I don't know what else possibly could. And so we're just so grateful and so very, very thankful. I'm trying to think if there's anything else. We repainted the whole clinic this year. We had a nice young lady who came up and did some really nice murals on the entryways and the walls, and it's a really welcoming environment. We've made some upgrades. We had to do some pretty significant electrical work in our agriculture program, and all of this is due to the continued support. I can't believe it. It's 24 years we've been open. In January, it will be 25. And that is quite an accomplishment. Even in just my time of being in Honduras, I saw new clinics go up and new clinics' doors be closed because they did not have the financial support for operating expenses, because many times donors would far prefer to pay for bricks and mortar, and you haven't done that. You've paid for salaries, you've paid for medication, you've paid for school supplies, you've bought animal feed and live animals, and most importantly, you've helped us sustain our staff, who have remained steadfast all these years. I don't know what we would do without the commitment of the staff, but the reason they can remain committed and the reason that they've been faithful and the reason they've been able to focus on their neighbor is because you, their neighbor, have focused on their well-being. And so praise be to God. Thank you so very much for everything you've done. Your generosity overwhelms me.
Sing another song here, and then we will have our closing, and then you can go over there and just bid yourself, just bid really high on, except the thing I bid on. Don't overbid on the thing that I bid on.
Once he sends us off, we'll have 15 minutes, and then we'll close it off. You don't think 15 minutes?
It's supposed to be a silent auction, okay. so no talking.
We'll go to
11. Terry, no talking during the silent auction.
11:15. Five. That clock right there. I have no idea whether it's right or wrong.
Thy word is a lamp.
Nothing will.
Before we part here, I do want to make a reminder, if you look in your bulletin, about the prayer concerns. Let's keep all of those in our prayers, looking over and not forget about them, because, you know, it is so important that we keep everyone in our hearts and we remember to connect with the Lord about that. Yes. Okay. Awesome. So if you didn't hear that, Sharon Jones, her daughter called, said she will be coming home from the hospital tomorrow, he said. So again, keep everyone in there, but you know, that's a celebration that we have her coming home, and so just continue to keep them in your prayers. As we go over here to have this time for some fun, and remember the people that we're serving, and just the impact that we can have just by coming together in a room and bidding on some baked goods. And to remember that, and that it is more than just going over the table. This is an impact on people's lives as they have an opportunity, and it's so amazing to hear the words of that their community is growing, and it sounds like it's thriving, and it's all that more important to continue to support them because of that opportunity for them to get to the point that they can continue forth, and we have helped be a part of that, and that is just so great. So go forth, help continue to promote this ministry, to promote the people of Honduras that we help serve. And if you think about one of the other things, sorry, my mind jumped here, how great that they are reaching out and serving the communities around them. They're not just stopping with themselves. They are now helping others, which means that our help isn't just going to the people we're directing it to, but even beyond that. And that to me is awesome to think about. So please join me in prayer, and then we will get moving. Thank you, Lord, for everything you've given us today and this opportunity to come together and to do your work. We thank you for the amazing work being done in Honduras and the amazing work that those people are doing that with what they have, and able to not only help themselves, but to reach out and help others. We thank you for this opportunity to be a part of that. But we know the real work is happening elsewhere, and we are a part. We are helping to maybe water a seed or be a small part of that, but still a part, and we celebrate that. We thank you for this opportunity, and we ask that you continue to work on our hearts that we may do more opportunities like this. We are grateful to have you here, and that you continue to watch over this church, continue to watch over the people serving those in Honduras, and we continue to watch over the people in Honduras. We thank you for this time, and we welcome having you here, that you may warm our hearts, fill us with your presence, and that we may do your work. In your name, amen. Amen.
I just want to thank everybody that brought all this stuff. You guys always come through. I'm always worried. And then at 9:45, I was worried because there was nobody here on these. So
they can't hear.
They want you on the mic. It's on, it's working.
Thank you for everybody that brought things this morning. You guys always come through, and I really appreciate it. And you also came through, I said, 9:45 when there was nobody at these tables. I thought, oh, my word, what are we going to do with all this stuff? So thank you, thank you, thank you for your support. Just remember, you're helping Honduras with all of this, but I appreciate your help.
Okay, I've got time to go on.
Okay. Well, we're going until 11:15. We're going until.